Good morning.
We are sitting here in the wonderful garden of the monastery of Gut Eich, and I'm happy that you have time that we can make this little interview. There will be a big celebration in the States honoring the 100th birthday of Thomas Merton. The organizers of this conference would have enjoyed your attendance, but unfortunately, that is not possible. So Anthony asked me if we could make an interview to show at the conference, and you said on Easter Sunday, of course, we will do that. So, Brother David, my first question would be, when and how did you have personal contact with Thomas Merton?
The first time I met him was when my abbot of Mount Xavier, a monastery in the United States, took me to Kentucky to meet Thomas Merton there. And whenever I remember that our meeting, there also comes to mind a poem by Mark van Doorn, who used to be Thomas Merton's teacher. And after Merton entered the monastery, visited him there for the first time. And he wrote this poem, which I think is, to me, a very moving poem. And I will try to recite it as best I can. Mark van Doorn calls it Once in Kentucky. And he writes, "In our fat times a monk, I had not thought to see one, nor ever with my own poor lean concerns ever to be one. No, but in Kentucky, midway of sweet hills, when housewives swept their porches and March light lapped windowsills, he, once my merry friend, came to the stone door, and all the difference in his smiling was, it sorrowed more." His merriment was graver, as if he knew now where it came from and what the flavor. He tasted it, the joy, then gave it all to me, as much, I mean, as I could carry home to this country whose laughter is a fat thing and dies. I stepped across its body and remember still those eyes. And this is a sort of romantic version of meeting Merton, but it is also in my own experience. And on the other hand, when I first saw him, he wasn't wearing the monastic habit, but his work outfit, his overalls, and I thought he was the milkman because he was carrying big milk cans. And also one thing that I remember from our first meeting and from every meeting with him, he was always so jolly, as Mark van Doorn says, he tasted it, the joy. He was always tasting the joy of life and gave it all to me. One couldn't talk with him for 5 minutes and we were all rolling with laughter. He always had something funny to tell. Mm-hmm. And that impressed me most of him, that it was obvious that he had this deep spirituality, as Mark van Doorn says, as if he knew now where the joy came, started from, and what the flavor really was. Mm. But he really was full of joy also in a simply everyday human way. Mm.
So might be there's already an answer to my second question. What was the most important impact of Thomas Merton's work or spirituality on your own path?
Well, I asked him once if the things that he wrote about our Christian faith, if he could have written those same things if it wasn't for his encounter with Buddhism, Zen Buddhism above all. And usually when you asked him a question like that, he would just laugh it off and give you some quick answer. But in this case, he said, well, I'll have to think about that. And then a little while later, he came back and he said to me, you know, this question about Buddhism, I think I could not understand our Christian faith the way I do if it wasn't in the light of Buddhism. And that was very important to me because it also encouraged me on my own path to understand our own Christian tradition more deeply through my contact with Zen Buddhism. He had a great deal of contact with Thich Nhat Hanh, for instance, and with Suzuki, not Junryu Suzuki, but the T.C. Suzuki, who wrote the earliest books, really, that introduced Zen to the United States. But he didn't have the practical experience which I had because I was studying at the Zendo. So I was interested in his much more developed theoretical insight, and he was more interested in my practical experience. So it was a very interesting and fruitful encounter we had.
So, Brother David, thank you for this answer. And from your practical experience from today, what could be your message to the conference?
Well, first of all, I'm very happy that I can meet you, all my our friends in Kentucky, in this way at least. And I think for all of us, it is important to continue to honor Thomas Merton by continuing in our time what he set in motion. And that is a deep understanding of other traditions, in his case particularly Zen Buddhism, not on a superficial way, but by going so deeply in our own tradition that we reach the point where all the traditions originate. And I can hardly imagine anything that is more important in our time than a deeper understanding between religious traditions. And if we work on it personally, and each of us and all of us together, I think this is will be the best way of honoring Thomas Merton on his 100th birthday.